These are unusual times, and it is having a very interesting widespread ripple effect across society. But to an extent, one must see how many people deserve what they're getting. So a lot of the people who at the moment are freaking out over, for example, what's going on in the US presidential election, and that is freaking a lot of people out, are people who still have at some residual level a reliance upon mainstream media. I was talking to somebody today, and she said, you know, of course, Joe Biden is the president-elect. No, he's not, I said. Oh, he is. No, he's not, I said. I said, where did you hear that from? Well, she said, everybody's been saying it. I said, everybody's wrong. But he is the president-elect. No, he's not. I said, who did you hear that from? I mean, apart from everybody. What's your more reliable source? RTE. I said, RTE are lying. Okay, I said, because the president-elect only acquires that position. It's not even an office, despite Biden's gaslighting. The president-elect only acquires the position of president-elect on the 6th of January 2021, and that is, of course, all without prejudice to whatever litigation may arise, and the litigation is serious and substantial. But the reality is, the best position to take in relation to the US presidential election is that I don't know. But I do know that Joe Biden is not the president-elect. Now, to what extent does a person who at this stage still relies on RTE for what they consider to be primary source information deserve any sympathy? To what extent does that person deserve any sympathy? It's hard to know. It's hard, you know, should they be accommodated? And this arises because something that's been occurring to me lately, particularly over the past 2 weeks, but it's been happening, it's been accumulating really over this particular insane year, is the amount of approaches I've had via direct messaging and to a certain lesser extent via social media posting. And people need to bear in mind that I'm not monetized and I have no intention of being monetized. Secondly, I'm not a lawyer. I'm not indemnified as a lawyer. I'm neither a barrister nor a solicitor. I cannot give and I shall not give legal advice to anyone. And if I am giving legal advice to people, I'm committing an offense. Now, there are certain quite limited circumstances where I can go into the High Court, first of all, representing myself, and secondly, with prior permission from, say, a nearest and dearest, like an elderly parent. But you have to get leave of the court beforehand. The courts don't want people just waltzing in saying that they're representing somebody. The courts are very clear about rules of meddling, and indeed, it is a sacrilege of paganism to meddle. If you don't have a title in court, and if you don't have standing in court, or if you are not previously cleared with the court to take a case on behalf of, say, a parent or a dependent loved one, and the courts will allow that, but they have to, the courts insist on the procedures being going through at least to the point where the actual presiding judge is satisfied that you're acting in good faith, then they'll throw you out because you're meddling. Meddling is a real sin in paganism, and then as you look more at it, you realise how sinful it is generally, whether you're a pagan or not. There are three very interesting films from 2007, The Mist, which is an adaptation of Stephen King's novella. It's a lot better than the original written edition. The Borderlands from 2013 and Veronica from 2017. And what those three movies have in common, there's also one is brought to mind. By the way, there are plot spoilers now coming around the corner. Okay, plot spoilers coming. But what one has in mind with those three movies, and indeed The Wicker Man of 1973, is the importance of not meddling. So, when people approach me wanting things, they seem to think that I'm willing to meddle and intervene. I'm not. I'm not willing to meddle and intervene. I recently offered to mediate in a particular situation, and then I discovered that they were using pseudo-law, so I dropped it. I walked away. Pseudo-law is one of the worst forms of black magic. It's a very, very sinful thing, pseudo-law. It's very evil, pseudo-law. Look it up if you don't know what I'm referring to. But I suppose I'm kind of being discursive about the particularly important thing. I'm not monetized. I'm just living with my parents. I'm sitting here at a computer talking into a mic. I don't even, this isn't even a video. This is a soundtrack recorded, which is then put behind a PNG or JPEG to allow it to be put onto YouTube. There isn't a video here. When you approach a person and you don't know them, even if you do know them, actually, the tone and approach that you use is exceptionally important. At the moment, I'm getting an awful lot of approaches, a hell of a lot, by direct message, both on Facebook and elsewhere. People who are genuinely in trouble, who are up the creek, that kind of thing. You know, I sympathise. But I'm not in the humour for people contacting me with demands. I'm very much not in the humour for that. This arose earlier this year regarding two planning judicial reviews, which I brought on hold. And people would email me or message me demanding to know what was happening next. I blocked them and I'd refuse to answer. Simple as that. I don't have to deal with people like that because I'm not taking money off anyone. And money is the key to this, really. If you're taking money off people, then you're answerable to the people who've paid you. I'm not taking money off anyone. And with my litigation, I pay for all of that myself, because litigating on your own, not using lawyers, is cheap as chips. To start a High Court case, to start a full injunction in the High Court, costs €280. That's a full injunction. The three pieces of paperwork you need to put in. One is 190, another is 30, and another is 60. Those are the three pieces of paperwork. So it's not dear to litigate on your own. And this is why, with those judicial reviews I brought on hold, I wouldn't countenance anybody giving me any money. I won't countenance it, because then I'm beholden to them. So I won't be beholden to anybody, and it is also exceptionally important that I should be able to set my own agenda. So this gets back to the tone of messages people were sending me in general, and I'm not going to deal with that. I'm not going to be disrespected, either publicly online or in private. Others are saying the same, and they're right. Those others are right. If you look at the films The Mist from 2007, The Borderlands from 2013, and Veronica from 2017, they are dealing in, so to at a greater tangent does The Wicker Man of 1973, but those three films, The Borderlands, The Mist and Veronica, are dealing with the issue of seers. What those three films have in common is that there are people in those films who are seers. In The Borderlands, there's the priest, Father Calvino. In The Mist, there's Mrs. Carmody. And in Veronica, there's Sister Death. Now, what those three characters, and they're fictional, of course, what those three characters have in common is that they are seers. Father Calvino, of the three characters there, Father Calvino would be the most genial and convivial of them all. Mrs. Carmody's an antichrist and Sister Death is a weirdo. That doesn't mean that they're not seers. And this is leading on to the next thing, into the pagan issue of the goddess Diana. The goddess Diana is traditionally a working class god. Diana would step in of her own volition for people who are in trouble or for situations of acute injustice. Diana was not amenable to being summoned. She was not amenable to that at all. And this is the same thing as is happening with, say, Mrs. Carmody or Sister Death, or to a lesser extent Father Calvino, and others in real life. People who are seers, or Thomas Sheridan used the term shamans, aren't necessarily the nice, polite people that you'd like to think that they are. They can sometimes be very awkward. They can sometimes be very thorny. So you have to deal with seers like that on their terms. Sister Death and Father Calvino were operating within the very tight Abrahamic structure of the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic Church, or their superiors in the church, particularly with Father Calvino, who came from the Vatican, and Sister Death, who was part of a religious order, they knew that these people were essentially psychic. They also knew that these people were very much off message in relation to church doctrine, but because of their psychic abilities, they were valuable to the church. The Roman Catholic Church, particularly, Thomas Sheridan has a great video about that, how they stole the All Father, very good video. It's very interesting because it shows the evolution of the church, of the Roman Catholic Church across Europe, and where it had to accommodate itself pragmatically to paganism. The church recognizes paganism. It won't admit that to you, but it recognizes paganism, and it recognizes that these people like Sister Death and Father Calvino know what's happening. They may know subconsciously, or they may not even be very conscious of themselves, but they know. And that these people are, however difficult they may be, valuable to the church. Because they allow the church to keep an eye on paganism and what's going on in reality. Sister Death was not an easy woman to deal with. Mrs. Carmody is also a seer in the mist. And she was shunned by her whole community. But what Father Calvino, Mrs. Carmody, and Sister Death all have in common is, in fact, by Thomas Sheridan's definition, they are shamans. They're outsiders. They're awkward. They're not easy to deal with. But it is perhaps that awkwardness and outside quality of them that gives them that bigger angle and that bigger perspective that allows them to be accurate seers. Don't go to a seer if you want to be reassured. A seer will tell you the truth. They won't tell you what you want to hear, but bloody often they'll tell you what you need to hear. And they will so often give you what you're looking for in a roundabout way, and they'll only say it once. And that's it. You go making demands to them, you know the answer you'll get. With Mrs. Carmody, she'd have put a fucking hex on you. Sister Death would have probably just gone to sleep, and Father Calvino would have, you know, said a few Hail Marys and been polite. But you cannot make demands of these people. You cannot make... They don't care about you. They're not looking for money. They're not... You know, they will give you a crumb of information, but it's how... Or a seed, perhaps. How you grow that seed is what matters. But you cannot expect these people to deal with you on your terms. It's the same with the goddess Diana. Diana would help out, willingly, but under no circumstances did you summon her or make demands. And this gets onto the occultic thing that we see in Verónica particularly. It also arose in the Borderlands, it didn't really arise in the mist. Verónica is dealing with a teenage girl who eventually kills herself. That's what actually happens. And this is after she did a seance where she summoned something that was better off not being summoned. But she summoned it. And Sister Death said to her, well, you know, you did it, didn't you? Well, maybe you shouldn't have, but you did. So now you have to deal with it, was what Sister Death said. Now, experienced psychics and experienced shamans, you know, there are jokes of the devil coming in somebody's window and saying, hey, I'm the devil here. And that somebody says, yeah, so what? So experienced psychics aren't worried about stuff like this, but experienced psychics know not to summon. And that's the difference. Whereas in Verónica, we were dealing with a 15-year-old girl who was not from an ideal home background and who brought down spirits which brought out the worst in Verónica. Many people have different approaches to paganism and spirituality. But a feature of paganism is recognizing, and it's a very central feature of paganism in my opinion, the supremacy of free will. Martin Luther and a lot of those nutjobs in the Reformation went on with predestination. Predestination's bullshit. The definition of human beings is that we have free will, and that's a very central tenet to paganism. You have free will, and that actually arose in The Wicker Man of 1973, where the Fall Guy was told in the end, you came here of your own free will, you were given many, many opportunities to see what was going on, you chose not to, you walked into this. And that's the truth of The Wicker Man. That is the truth. That is the truth of the Wicker Man. He walked into it. I've put up videos in the past about Micheál Martin, who's presently in the nominal King for a Day role of Irish Taoiseach, or Prime Minister to those who don't know the post. He's walked into that, and oh, who knows? Who knows what's going to happen there? He's King for a Day, Micheál Martin is, because he reached an agreement. He reached this Faustian pact with that article, Varadkar, where they're doing the rotating Taoiseach. The founding fathers of this republic did not set up the role of Taoiseach to be rotating. It's not constitutionally banned, but they didn't realise they'd be dealing with people as stupid as Micheál Martin. That's the truth of it. There's no such thing as a rotating Taoiseach. It's bullshit to have a rotating Taoiseach. That's like suggesting there'd be a rotating US presidency. Try that one on with Trump, see how we take it. Oh, we'll have a rotating presidency. You take it on for the first 2 years, I'll take it on for the next two. Trump would say, no, I'll just come back and run again in 2024. That would be Trump. Because Trump understands these things. And Trump frightens the mainstream, because not because he's so stupid, but because he's so clever and he's so sharp. That's why the mainstream don't like Trump. He's not playing their game. He's not beholden to them. So, getting back to where we were. A seer owes you nothing. The princess, the Freudian slip there. The goddess Diana owes you nothing. They owe you nothing. So you be very careful with the tone and approach that you use when you approach a seer. Or let them come to you with the little seed that they might want to have. I remember some years ago being quite aggrieved at something that a seer brought to me. Quite aggrieved at the time. But even at the time I knew that he was right. I knew that he was right. But it wasn't a comfort zone for me, but I had to take on board what he'd said. I had to consider what this man had said. I won't say who it was or where it was. But this was a person who had a lot of respect within the community he worked, and who actually could be very rigidly and crudely fair with those he dealt with. So I knew that beforehand. As uncomfortable as I was, I had to at least ask myself, why is he saying that about you? Why is he saying that about you? Ask yourself that. What motivates this? What's this motivated by? So, always bear in mind that people, particularly those like myself who are unmonetized, don't owe you anything. If you give them money on Patreon or that kind of thing, well, then it's a different relationship. Whether they accept it or not, it is a different relationship. But those of us who are not getting money, we don't have to answer to anyone. I could close down all my social media tomorrow. I could walk off social media tomorrow if I wanted to. And I owe nobody nothing in that regard. I owe nobody nothing in that particular regard with social media. So there's been a lot of messaging happening and a lot of contact being made, and that's valid and that's acceptable, and people are distraught. Maybe, though, those people should be considering whether their distress has been caused, whether they're aware of it or not, by mainstream media. The one piece of advice I'd give to you is to switch off RTE and stop reading the Irish Times. Never known to fail.